Yazoo! Yazoo Lands? The Yazoo River? What is this? A children's book?
Not at all. The Yazoo Lands were a key part of a political scandal in the state of Georgia in the late 1700s.
It's a funny name.
The French explorer La Salle named it after the Native American Yazoo tribe.
That's Yazooferous!
Enough.
Why is it in the museum?
The Yazoo Land scandal led to a U.S. Supreme Court case in 1810. It was the first time the court, which had only been in existence for 21 years, had to determine whether a state law was constitutional.
That's interesting. And where is this land of Yazoo?
The Yazoo Lands are located in the current states of Alabama and Mississippi.
We should go visit.
Visit?
I kind of want to see the land involved in this landmark decision. See what I did there? Landmark decision. Pun intended.
Okay, you funny gaffo. Let's go check it out. The year was 1795. The Treaty of Paris, which officially ended the Revolutionary War, had been signed only 12 years earlier. The state of Georgia, America's youngest and least inhabited state, claimed possession of the Yazoo Lands, a 54,000 square mile region occupied by the Native American Yazoo tribe. The legislature divided the area into four tracts of land, and Governor George Matthews signed into law a bill authorizing the sale of the land to four development companies for a total of $500,000. This was called the Yazoo Act.
Whoa, that was a lot of money, especially back then.
Oh, it was, but the land developers actually got a great bargain. They paid...
Wait, I got this. $500,000 divided by 54,000 square miles, which is 34,560,000 acres, 1.5 cents per acre. Wow!
Yes, wow. Today, you can pay more than $500,000 for 1 acre of land.
And the developers got more than 34 million acres? That's crazy!
Well, it did seem a little too good to be true.
Oh? What do you mean?
Well, the Yazoo Act was approved by the legislators in exchange for money bribes and shares in the development companies.
No!
Yes. State officials, newspaper editors, and all but one of the state legislators took bribes to secure the vote.
That's despicable.
The Supreme Court later agreed with you, referring to these devious acts as deplorable.
I'll say.
Luckily, the following year, Georgia, led by U.S. Senator James Jackson, voted out these scoundrels and brought in new legislators who declared the land transfer invalid. They destroyed records, revised the state constitution, and tried to make the whole thing go away. However, the scandal couldn't just go away because some of the land had already been sold to other buyers.
Uh-oh. I hear lawsuits coming.
Yes. In 1800, John Peck bought part of the land. 3 years later, he sold the land to a man named Robert Fletcher. The two of them signed a contract based on Fletcher's understanding that Peck owned the land. However, the legislature declared the original land conveyance invalid, so Fletcher sued Peck for selling him land he didn't own and argued that he thereby had committed a breach of contract.
Ooh. So Peck bought land and sold it to Fletcher, but Georgia then told Peck he didn't own it in the first place?
Exactly.
What did the court say?
Well, since Fletcher and Peck were from different states, the case originated in the federal court in Massachusetts. The circuit court ruled in favor of Peck. Fletcher appealed to the U.S. Supreme Court.
Okay, let me get this straight. Peck sold land to Fletcher that he bought from the state of Georgia.
Correct.
Fletcher argued that Peck didn't own the land.
Because?
Because Georgia never owned the land in the first place.
Maybe. And that's what the Supreme Court had to decide. The real issue was not whether Peck owned the land, but whether the Georgia legislature should have been allowed to repeal the Yazoo Act in the first place.
I see. But wasn't the original bill passed through fraudulent means, like bribes and stuff?
It was, but it was still a law, and after it became a law, people acted on it.
People like Peck and Fletcher.
Right.
Too much for my little brain. It's a good thing we have the Supreme Court to sort this out.
Supreme Court Justice John Marshall wrote the opinion of the court.
Ooh, I like him.
And here's what he wrote.
It would be indecent, upon a private contract between two individuals, to enter into an inquiry respecting the corruption of the sovereign power of a state. If the title be plainly deduced from a legislative act, with all the requisite forms of a law, a court cannot sustain a suit found on the allegation that the act is a nullity in consequence of the impure motives which influence certain members of the legislature which passed the law.
So, basically, the court said that even though some of the Georgia state legislators were involved in corrupt behavior when they voted for the law, it would be wrong to void a contract made under that law.
Correct. The court said that a law can be repealed, but acts done under that law cannot. It would be unconstitutional to void Peck and Fletcher's contract, which was protected by the Contracts Clause of the U.S. Constitution.
What's that?
Well, Article 1, Section 10, Clause 1 provides that a state cannot pass a law which interferes with private contracts. Contracts are found in all aspects of life, from the mortgage on your house, to your car loan, to your cell phone bill. Without the Contracts Clause, people would always be uncertain about their rights and obligations to each other.
Contracts are really important. So, the Supreme Court upheld the lower court's decision?
Yes, and by so doing, extended the doctrine of judicial review to state actions.
I remember judicial review. We learned how that was established in Marbury versus Madison. Judicial review refers to the power of the federal courts to declare legislative and executive laws or acts invalid if they violate the Constitution.
Yes! What a good memory you have. However, Marbury versus Madison involved an action by the federal government. Fletcher versus Peck was the first time a state law had been ruled unconstitutional by the Supreme Court. This decision also further established the Supreme Court and the U.S. Constitution as the superior authorities over state laws. It's interesting to me that some people consider this a win-win case.
What do you mean by that?
Both sides benefited by Peck winning. Peck got to keep his money, and Fletcher got to keep his land.
So, if Fletcher had won, then...
The Native American Yazoo tribe might have gotten their land back.
Wow. So the Yazoo tribe is really the one who lost here.
Perhaps. If you're interested, Worcester versus Georgia sheds more light on the struggles Native Americans faced in this region. In that video, you can learn about the infamous Trail of Tears, which occurred when Georgia relocated the Cherokee people to Oklahoma. Some commentators have argued that by approving Georgia's assertion of ownership over Yazoo territory, Fletcher v. Peck, in a sense, led to the Trail of Tears.
I'll definitely check that out. There is so much information on this website.
Yes, there is. For example, did you know that Peck was represented in his appeal by then-Senator John Quincy Adams? Adams became the first future president to argue a case before the nation's highest tribunal.
Yes, I did know that.
Well, how did you know that already?
I read the summary paragraph below this video.
Okay, I see, smarty pants.
Hey, maybe we should go look at another page together?